Okay, so I wasn't able to finish the session that I started in the morning, so I will probably try to wrap it up in maybe 20 minutes. So we looked at what every new business is not a startup. We looked at what is a startup, and we looked at the first two milestones that a startup founder will have to work towards. One is the proof of product and the proof of business, right? And then we said, well, starting up is not very different from what you see in this picture, right? It's about putting a seed into the ground, close it with soil, put manure, put some water, and then wait for a few days, and then you see this sapling. Now we said if this sapling were to grow up and become a tomato plant or a banyan tree, depends on the seed, right? And we said that seed possibly equates to the idea with which you started, right? So the urge, the encouragement is to see if startup founders can come up with an idea that has the potential to become a much bigger business as opposed to remaining a small profitable business, right? So a small business owner versus a startup founder, it essentially comes down to how are you able to look at your idea with the potential to become something big as opposed to remaining something small and yet profitable. Right now, when we define this scalable enterprise, we basically said it all comes down to the rate at which revenue grows vis-a-vis the rate at which cost grows, right? And the more there is the gap between these two curves, the more profitable the growth is. And that's what essentially we mean by a scalable enterprise, right? And what we see happen in the last maybe 30 to 40 years is ventures, founders of those ventures use technology, and it's largely due to technology that such a revenue curve and a cost curve is actually made possible, right? So the question is, how do you get revenue to grow at NX but keep the cost at X? Any ideas? So what do these technology business models have that make this possible? No geographical limitations, right? So which means your supply as well as your demand, right, is not totally dependent on physical, you know, boundaries and logistical activities. So the more asset light you are, you can make this possible, right? So Redbus, you know, can do this. Whereas, can you expect Himachal Pradesh tourist bus transportation to be able to achieve this? Not likely, right? What else? What else do you need for the revenue to just keep climbing? What's the one thing that you need for the revenue to keep climbing? Can you have an ever climbing revenue curve in a smaller market? Right? So then it comes down to the choice of your target market. Right? Are you setting up yourself in playing in a market that has the potential to become much, much bigger, or the business has the potential to become a big player in a much, much bigger market? So they talk in terms of, are you a big fish in a small pond, or are you a very small fish but in a very big pond with potential to become even bigger and bigger? Right? So if you were to sort of look at, you know, this, it essentially comes down to, is there a big business potential behind this startup? Right? Now what determines this big business potential? A huge target market, right? And the possibility to be a market leader with a huge share of the market, right? Naturally, you know, large size of the market translates to ever-increasing revenues, right? And with the fact that you use technology to lower the costs, right, helps you achieve that scale with high profitable growth, right? Business is not revenue. Business is profit, right? So if you were to sort of look at, you know, through the words of Warren Buffett, so he says, if you want to build a billion-dollar business, go solve a billion-dollar problem, right? So where will you get this next big business idea from? Well, hopefully solve a billion dollar problem, you might get a chance to build a $1 billion business, right? Now, what is this $1 billion problem? Essentially, a problem that impacts a billion people. It's B2C, or it's a problem that's worth $1 billion, B2B, right? So that's a billion dollar business. That's a $1 billion problem. It makes up for a $1 billion business potential, right? Now let's look at an example. Let's look at the example of Google AdWords, right? Now before Google got into the advertising market, how did the advertising market of the world look like? It actually resembled an iceberg. What's the tip of the iceberg? Those 5,000 large enterprises, call it the global 5,000 companies, right? Those 5,000 large enterprises who actually can afford mainstream, full-fledged advertising services, which were provided by ad agencies of all size and color, right? Now, what's the usual ad advertising agency model? They come, they get the brief from the client. They say, oh, here is, let's say Procter & Gamble wants to launch a new product in the US market, right? And they would say, yeah, you know what, we've earmarked a $10 million budget for advertising for this 1 year. Can you come up with an ad campaign, right? And then they would go, do all the study, the research, and they would come out with a complete, soup to nuts ad strategy, ad plan, ad model, and they would say, here is how we're going to spend these $10 million, and here is what we promise to achieve in terms of impressions, outcomes, revenue, sales, yada, yada, yada. Right? So that's how the world of advertising looked like before Google came in with Google AdWords. But what did actually Google do? It said, now what's below the water level? Right? Below the water level, you have these millions and millions of small businesses, small enterprises, right, which were completely ignored. Their needs for advertising services were completely ignored by those ad agencies who were serving the tip of the iceberg. Right? Now, here is a guy who says, well, you know what, I do a 2 crore a year business. Right? I have a 2 lakh ad budget. Push it, you'll get 4 lakhs. Can the conventional ad agency model cater to the advertising needs at 4 lakhs? Impossible, right? The model is very sophisticated and too complex and too high cost for it to be able to fit into a 4 lakh budget. But what does Google do? You actually can theoretically run a Google AdWords campaign with $1. I mean, it's not going to spit you on your face. Right? You can still go ahead. I mean, the OK and all of that will work. The buttons will, you can actually click all the way to the logical end of the screen and say, OK, campaign accepted. Yes or no? I mean, what can come out of the $1 is questionable. But I'm saying it's still, Google is not going to, like I said, spit at you, right? Yeah. So Google says, I'm going to make advertising democratized. And I'm going to solve that huge problem that the millions and millions of enterprises and small enterprises and businesses who are ignored are facing. They need advertising too, right? I can put 1,000 rupees, I can put 5,000 rupees, I can even put a lakh, right? But can you help me fix my problem, which is I am not able to do advertising for my business, right? So Google puts tech to work, and it opens up a huge market. And the market is a million times bigger. Right? So what did it actually do? Google created a market. Right? So what are the chances of Google going top down? I mean, imagine, right? Google launched AdWords. Aditya is the VP of sales for AdWords. And he says, oh, you know what? My first stop is Procter & Gamble. Procter & Gamble is coming up with a new product. They have $10 million ad budget. And there is this guy from Ogilvy & Mather. And there is Aditya from Google AdWords. Do you have a chance? Right? So for a startup to get into an existing market, you're taking on established players who have a very full-fledged, very comprehensive, very sophisticated product. Now, vis-a-vis that, your
technology is not mature enough, right? Your value proposition is not proven enough. And when the guy has the ability to pay top dollar, why would he go for someone who is not proven? Right? So going top down, going after existing markets for a startup is extremely difficult. Unless you have a Bansal last name and you can raise some serious money. And you have a very patient investor who says, yeah, I'll fund your losses forever. And your divorce too. Right? So the point is, for startups, it's not so much market invasion. Right? It's market creation. There could be possibilities of getting into market expansion, which is niches in the existing market. This is like cracks in the tip of the iceberg. What Myntra did. Right? What do? You get into the niche, you play well, and if the biggie calls you up and says, well, you know what, we want to hire you at these terms, say thank you and get hired. Don't piss off the biggie. Because he'll come with all guns blazing now. And he'll wipe you out of the market. Because his financial stability is much, much bigger. Because for him, he deals with marginal costs. Whereas you just put $1 million down to build a platform. Your CFO is after your everything. Right? So for a startup to think in terms of where is this big business potential, it basically starts with where is this big market that I can create. You can't create a big market by invading the existing market and pulling market share away. No. Reliance Jio can do that. But you know what it cost them? Even before the first call was made, 1.5 lakh crores. Yeah, so either you are Ambani or Bansal. So we spoke about proof of product, we spoke about proof of business, right? The third milestone that a startup founder will have to work towards is proof of scale, right? So we're saying, can your business model show the possibility of this revenue curve and cost curve, NX at X, which basically sets up the business model to be profitably scalable. And what we mean by business model, basically all of these operations, right? It's through these operations that you generate revenues, and to operate these operations, you incur costs. Are you able to show that the revenue and the cost curve have a big gap between them? That's proof. Right? So the thing is, are you thinking about it? Right? I don't know how many of you read this recent post on Kunal Bell, rolling back Snapdeal operations down to a manageable size which can be a profitable operation. Right? So for a startup founder, proving viability is not one of whether this can become a small business or it can become an unprofitably scaling up business. The viability here is in terms of, can this become a highly scalable business? That's the viability that we are looking for, right? So viability basically means, is it economically profitable? That's what actually viability means. Does it make economic sense to run this business? Yeah, then it's viable. Right, but we're not talking economic, sense in terms of, yeah, this can become a small profitable business. We're talking economic sense in terms of, is there a possibility that there is a high profitable growth of revenues that can come from this startup idea? So, a startup founder has to build proof for big business potential. Proof for solving a big problem at scale with a business model that is profitably scalable. Right? So if you can put the specifics to it, it becomes your vision statement. Right? You put specifics to it, it becomes your vision statement. I'm going to skip this, just another version of this. All right. So let's say my objective is to climb Mount Everest. I mean, many of us are using Everest today. Saurabh just did. Right? So I wake up one fine morning and I have this, you know, obsessive, very compulsive desire to climb Mount Everest, and I start calling people, hey, you know what, I want to climb Mount Everest, what do I do, what do I do? And they tell me, well, you know what, you just have to go, there are these, you know, travel agencies out of Delhi or maybe Shimla, Manali, you just go there and just get yourself enrolled, maybe in the next expedition they'll take you in. So I actually, you know, go there and I find this travel agency who sets up, you know, expeditions for Mount Everest. And then I go register myself, and then he says, well, you know what, you need to go meet that head mountain climber coach who will have to select you. So I go up to him, he looks at me up and down, and I say, well, can you make me part of your next expedition to climb Mount Everest? And he looks at me up and down, right? And in his mind, he basically is running sort of like a checklist, right? His checklist is looking at items, is this guy healthy? Is this guy athletic? Right? Does he know mountain climbing? Does he know to use the various gadgets and tools and other devices that are part of the whole mountain climbing thing? Do I know how to work as part of an expedition team? Right? It's not just an individual climbing, right? You actually work in a team, right? So do you know all the chores? Do you know how to handle communications? Do you know how to handle wireless radio equipment? Do you know how to do first aid? Do you know how to cook? Do you know how to manage other several things, right? So it's almost like this big checklist. Right? And he's basically going to say yes or no if I put a tick on all items on that checklist. Right? I got rejected. Naturally, I'm not even close. Now, if I really have to make meaningful effort towards becoming part of the expedition and to actually start attempting a climb to the summit of Mount Everest, what is that first milestone that I have to achieve? The first minimum milestone that I have to achieve? Sorry?
Get fit.
Get fit? Go talk to the guy. Is that the minimum? What I mean by minimum is anything, you know, below that does not even matter. With a gear, you think I'm ready to climb Mount Everest? Define smaller mountain.
There's something which you can climb first to see if you can actually mountain climb. Then try mountain.
What is that? So what is it that I have to climb for this guy to make me part of the next expedition? It's actually very simple. I have to get to the base camp. Right? But by the way, the Everest base camp is not some little hill. It's 18,500 feet. If it were a peak on its own, it would be the 12th tallest peak in the world. It's not a hillock. Right? But if I can get to this base camp, have I put a tick in all that items on the checklist? Now if I go and say, yeah, can you make me part of the next expedition? It makes sense. Because I'm ready. Right? So, ambition to summit Mount Everest. This is potential, right? I'm envisioning something huge, something very big. Right? Now, when will this potential start looking real? When I get to the base camp, because that becomes the proof. I have the proof that I'm now ready to climb to the top. I have the proof for the potential. At this point of proof, potential starts looking real. So Eric Schmidt very famously, closed the first round of a big ticket funding for Google post his coming on board as CEO of Google. Right? They raised something like $175-180 million at about a little over $1 billion in valuation. Right? And he very famously said, so this is Eric Schmidt. He had about 22 years of Fortune 10, Fortune 15 CEO experience before he was hired by Google, Harvard business graduate and all of that, right? He's run $20-25 billion a year revenue companies. That's the size of companies he's run before. He stands before Kleiner Perkins and he says, I'm giving you a chance to invest in the next $100 billion advertising business. Right? Now, Kleiner Perkins must be a fool not to invest. I mean, they must be thinking, well, if Eric Schmidt is saying it, it better be true, right? Put money in. But the point is, he saw that potential, right? He said the potential is $100 billion a year ad company, and they came very close to it. He said this in 10 years. He said this in 2002, 2003. So which means 2012, 2013 was the target date. Last year when they closed, it was about $96 billion, was I think Google's revenue for the year, and about 90 was from ad sales. Right? Yes, yeah. So he came short by $10 billion 5 years late. Big deal. Right? So he put that potential, but what was the proof that backed it up? A simple number. Google.com, right, was picking up few million new users every month, right? And the number of users on Google.com was doubling every quarter or something like that. That's the number. Right? So he was able to show this potential linked to the proof that you now have a platform on which you can do advertising at fraction of the cost. What was Eric Schmidt doing before he came to Google? He was fighting for $15, $20, $100 million a year ad budgets when he was running $20 billion companies. Right? He understands the pain of what a CEO goes through when his marketing ad team comes and says, we got to plonk $100 million down the ad line. He gets it, right? He says, and he looks at these numbers and he says, guys, are you kidding? If I do a $10 million campaign for a 2.5 minute slot in the US, what's that? The Super Bowl, right? It's $10 million for 2.5 minutes. And what do you get? About 65 million, 70 million impressions. That's the number of households who watch primetime Super Bowl live. Look at the math. $10 million for 70 million impressions, like seven times. And look at this. At what cost? Zero. It's a one-time server cost. And what impressions are you talking? Million impressions, new impressions every month, doubling every month. Right? So he was able to connect this to the potential of a $100 billion a year ad company, but the proof was very clear to that. Right? So if you have this proof, yeah, now that potential looks real. Right? So that's the mindset that startup founders will have to get into. Right? So what's the first milestone in building a high growth, a high profitable growth, scalable enterprise? Right? The one that has revenue at 10x, cost at x. Revenue at nx, cost at x. Right? So what we did, you know, essentially what I did is come up with this concept of a minimum viable business. Right? So it shows three kinds of proof. Proof of product, proof of business, proof of scale. And at that milestone, I'm actually connecting to something much, much bigger. So for a startup founder, it gives you a direction to work towards. It connects a lot of otherwise unconnected dots. Puts you on a framework of strategic thinking and planning. Right? So this MVP mentality to the MVB mentality. Because what usually happens with the MVP mentality that I've seen is that they take the business out of the equation. And they tend to equate MVP to a prototype. MVP is not a prototype. By definition, MVP has a price tag. It's another matter that you give it at 100% discount and then make it free. Right? But the mentality is, I'm not building a product, I'm building a business. And that viability that I'm building towards is not of a small business, but of something which can become big in the future. Right? So the three essential components to this MVP. The first is potential. What's the potential that you are thinking about your business in the future, right? So what is that scalable business model to solve a big problem? Now for that potential, what's the proof that will make that potential look real? What smallest size, scale, business shall prove the viability of such a high potential business model? And then you work towards that proof. Because it really does not matter thinking beyond the proof point. So what is the financial operating plan to achieve that proof? Right? So you're breaking things down into, do I have the ambition to set myself up for something really big? What will prove that this something really big will become real? And am I planning to build that proof? Think in terms of how investors, early stage investors, late stage investors work with founders. There's a way to actually connect to this. How does an early stage investor think? He basically says, if I find someone who has this ambition to set something up for really big, I'm going to help him build proof, because proof building takes money. Right? And what does he think? If you can help me build that proof with my money, together we will go to a late stage investor who's basically saying, I'll give you money to go from proof to potential. Easy way to understand investors' thinking. Right? So how to build proof of product. So what we do is we have a 3-day boot camp that I've been doing for about 18, 20 months now, close to about 35, 40 boot camps we've done. 700 plus startup founders have gone through our boot camps. We work with funds, we work with other accelerator partners, as well as ecosystem players like NASCOM, TIE, and several others, right? And through the boot camp, we actually break these three things down: proof of product, proof of business, proof of scale. And each of these has, together there are 10 elements that make up the minimum viable business framework, right? So the first three things for proof of product: minimum critical problem, first target customer, the minimum viable product. Right? So we spoke about this MOOC platform example in the morning. Right? So who's the first target customer? The small IT company. The small IT company.
Yeah.
Right?
But you provide.
No, I did the exact opposite. We started with saying, yeah, we will sell it to students. And we said, yeah, students are not going to buy it. So who's your first target customer? The small IT company. Right? And what was the product? A resume catalog with interview scheduling and skill assessment report and customized training. Right? So it gets you to sell rather than just keep building. Right? You could have built a MOOC platform forever, but no one's ever going to pay for it. Right? But you can actually work backwards and say, okay, I start with this, and then I start finding value adds, value additions.
This
right?
Is where most of the entrepreneurs actually don't understand.
Effectuation, right? So the mentality is not to build, the mentality is to sell. Right? So what will guide you to that? The choice of these three things. So these are the decisions you have to make. Right? Beyond proof of product, we go on to proof of business. So there are three things which characterize this milestone. What's the maximum value to partners? Because the approach here is to not build everything yourself. What capacity, what assets can I utilize from others in the ecosystem that can help me create and deliver and capture value in an expedited manner? Because what am I trying to prove in proof of business? I got to start showing the gap between revenue and costs, right? Easiest way to do is to hire capacity. So it's a cost of sales, right? So you can start showing the margins are healthy now. Unit economics picks up, right? And then repeatable acquisition of customers with sales and revenues repeatable too. Lowest cost of customer acquisition with leading to positive gross margins. So these are essentially fundamentals, right? So the idea is not to get into the specifics. So I talk in terms of, this is not about giving you a blueprint. You can't give an entrepreneur a blueprint. Ultimately, it's the creature's ego which is going to make the business successful.
It's his DNA.
Right? So you can't give a blueprint. So what do? We give a scaffolding. Right? So when you're building a building, let's say you're saying, you know what, I want to build this very innovative building never built before, never designed before. I can't give you a blueprint. But what I'm doing is, well, whatever you build, you basically need this scaffolding on which you stand and build whatever you want to build. Right? Think of it as difference between giving you a compass and giving you a map. I can give you a map of something which is already charted. But if you're doing something not done before, you got to draw the map. And what do I give you? I give you the compass. It will do one thing, show north. Right? So these are fundamentals that you have to keep in mind as you build out from an idea and try to make that into an enterprise. Right? The next thing is proof of scale. Right? So where is that gap between the revenue curve and the cost curve? How is that going to come from? You know, where is it going to come from? How do you get that to happen? How do you make that happen? You need a big target market. Right? So how are you defining your target market matters? So if you're going after an existing market and saying, well, that's big enough, well, sorry. It takes a lot of money to move market share out of an existing market from one player to another player. Right? The next thing is multiple revenue sources, naturally. Right? Easiest way to do this. I am creating value. Can I look at ways to monetize this across multiple different beneficiaries? So that I get more for less. So more revenue for less cost. Right? A networked business ecosystem. This is where technology plays a huge role. Right? In creating a networked business ecosystem so that even if you were to build on the ground assets and capacity and not be a pure play tech operations business, you still can use the power of technology wherever appropriate and see if other entities in the ecosystem are networked so that your cost is lower as you're scaling up revenues. And of course, increasing gross margins. Right? This is both economies of scale, economies of scope, and all of those things. Right? That naturally happens as you scale up. Right? So this is what we've done. The one thing that actually stands out in these boot camps is that we bring in mentors and we have very in-depth mentoring conversations on these 8 mentoring tracks. Right? So they are hand-picked mentors who are given a brief, who also understand the MVB methodology, and then they actually work with startups on a one-on-one basis. So this is what happens over 3 days. Thank you.